Is every single action that our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did something that is legislative for us to follow? Or are some of his actions that which is not something that is legislated upon us?
وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِن قَبْلِكَ إِلَّا رِجَالًا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِمْ فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ.
And this is a question that deals with the topic of usul al-fiqh, or how we derive fiqh. And it's a very, very important aspect of usul al-fiqh. So I thought I would summarize some of the main issues pertaining to that. Once again, the question is, the Prophet's actions, is everything that he did, without exception, something that is legislated by Allah upon us? Or is there some category of his actions that are not legislated upon us? And the brother gave a number of examples. I'm going to answer them within the context of my response. And by the way, this topic is a very well-known topic in Usul al-Fiqh. It is called the A'mal, or the actions of the Prophet. Many dissertations have been written. One of the famous scholars of our times who passed away recently, Shaykh Umar Sulaiman al-Ashqar, his PhD in Usul al-Fiqh was about the actions of the Prophet. Obviously, it's a very detailed topic. In a nutshell, we can say there are three broad categories of actions of the Prophet ﷺ, and by extension, even his statements. Firstly, the rituals and the theology that he spoke and the rituals that he did. There is no difference of opinion that every ritual and every statement that he commands us about the religion and every statement about theology and about iman and ghaib, this is a part of our religion of Islam. And to reject it is to reject Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَنْ يُطِعِ الرَّسُولَ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. Whoever follows the Prophet has followed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our Prophet said, pray as you have seen me pray. He's doing action. Even if he doesn't say it, pray as you have seen me pray. Our Prophet said when he's going for Hajj, take your rites of Hajj from me. خُذُوا عَنِّي مَنَاسِكَكُمْ. Whatever I'm doing for Hajj, take it from me. So there is no controversy at all that the actions and statements that deal with how to worship Allah, how to pray, how to fast, belief in Allah, iman in qadr and judgment and ashrat al-sa'ah, signs of judgment day, all of this is a part and parcel of Islam. Whoever rejects it has rejected Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second category of actions in particular are those actions that deal with the culture and habit and custom of his people that he happened to do because he lived at a certain time and place. And by and large, there is no controversy at all that those actions are not binding on the rest of the ummah. The classic example is how he lived, the structure that he lived in. Must we replicate that structure? The architecture of Medina, the modes of transportation, how he went from city to city. Is it rewarding by Allah that we give up our car and we take a camel and we go from city to city? No real scholar says this, and really no alim says this, right? It is not legislative. The max you can derive, it is permissible, mubah. But it is not rewarding to abandon the car and to take a camel or a horse or any other mode of that time. The mechanism of war, is it sunnah? In fact, it would be foolish that we, if there was a land of Islam, that they abandon modern warfare and they go back to swords and javelins and whatnot, right? That's not, so that's something that pretty much by unanimous consensus, that this is not something that is legislative upon us. He happened to like a certain cuisine. That cuisine, it is not legislative upon us that we abandon our cuisine and we rediscover the cuisine of Medina or Mecca in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And in fact, this is explicit, and the Sahaba clearly understood this. And the best example for this is the hadith in Bukhari of the dab, or the lizard animal, that the people of Mecca, by and large, did not generally eat the dab, and it was something that was a delicacy in Medina. And some people, they are very conservative in their mechanism. They want to eat what their parents ate. And others are more foodies. They want to go out and they want to experiment the world, right? So when the dab was presented to the Prophet, what did he say? He didn't say it's haram. He said, That's just not from the food of, I don't like it personally. This is his personal choice. None of the room abstained from eating. And there were great sahaba in that room. This is a very, very key point, that the personal preferences of the Prophet ﷺ, he as a human being, he doesn't like the dhab. And he said this. He didn't say Allah made it haram. He didn't say the sharia. He said, this is not from the food of the people of Makkah, my people. And it's not haram. So Khalid ibn al-Walid, who himself was a Qurashi, but apparently he's a foodie as well. Okay? He dived in and he ate the dhab. This is a very interesting hadith, because here we have the action of the Prophet ﷺ that everybody understood. That's your action, it's not the sharia. You understand this point? This is a very explicit thing, that the personal habits and the personal customs of the Prophet ﷺ does not become legislative. There is a third category, and this is the gray area. And that is when we're not quite sure if something is category one or two, because there's an element of both. There's an element of both. We're not quite sure where to categorize them. And this is where the controversy occurs. And generally speaking, it's a case-by-case basis. I'll give you some simple examples. Sometimes, even in the rituals, something occurs that seems to be, perhaps, by culture or preference and not by religion. The classic example is, Aisha says, when the Prophet ﷺ became older, so his joints are weaker, so he also gained some weight, because when you grow older, your metabolism goes down. Not that he ate extra food, but as we know, your metabolism goes down. Aisha said, when he grew older, this is something later on he did, then he would sit down, jalsatul istiraha, it's called, when the first and the third rak'ah. That you know, the first rak'ah, when you do sajda, you go straight up, right? And the third rak'ah, you go straight up. Well, in one hadith it is mentioned, towards the end of his life, when the joints got weak, when the weight was there, the Prophet ﷺ would take a bit of a breather. Just sit down and then stand up. He didn't tell us to do that. It's not a command. When you get up from the third rak'ah, sit down. The Sahaba are observing, and they're saying themselves, when he gained weight, when the bones became weak. So even seems they understood that he did this because, you know, at that age to jump up and from the sujood might be a little bit difficult. So you take a little bit of a break, then you get up. Now we have a clash here. Is it category one, ritual, or is it category two, personal habit? So some of the madhabs understood it category one, and this is the default, this is the minority position. The Hanbali madhab says this. And the majority of the madhabs, the Hanafis and the Malikis and the Shafis, they say just that istiraha is not a part of the sunnah. We don't have to do it unless you're old or unless you have joint problems. But the default is you don't do that. You see, we have a little bit of a clash here. As well, what if the commandment, even the verbal commandment, what if the verbal issue is not about this world, it's not about the akhirah, it's not about halal and haram, it is about umur ad-dunyawiyya. This is another controversy, because the famous hadith in Sahih Bukhari, our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam once passed by the farmers in Medina, and they were cross-fertilizing the dates. So there's a female part and a male part, and rather than rely on the bees and rely on Mother Nature, rely on wind, they would take the male part and put it onto the female, so the pollen cross-pollinization occurs, and then the date basically forms, the pollination occurs, and therefore the new seed forms. The Prophet ﷺ said, why don't you let it naturally? Why do you do it yourself? Let it go. So that year, none of the farmers did it. And the crops did not come out. The hadith is in Bukhari, by the way. The farmer said, Ya Rasulullah, you told us, actually he didn't say don't do it, he's asking, why don't you? Another point. Why don't you just leave it? See what happens. They left it. Nothing happened. It worked. It didn't work. So the Prophet ﷺ gave that famous response, أَنْتُمْ أَعْلَمُ بِأُمُورِ دُنْيَاكُمْ. You know your dunya better than I do. This is a clear example that the Prophet says, look, it was just a human suggestion. This isn't from Allah Azza wa Jal. As a human to another, we all have the right to give opinions. And this is just an opinion I gave. But in the end of the day, you are the experts in farming. I am not the expert in farming. You know your farming better than I do. And the famous incident in the Battle of Badr as well, where the Prophet ﷺ camped at a particular location, and one of the Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, this location that you stopped at, is it something Allah commanded, or is it something that you think is the best place? He said, no, Allah didn't command. He said, in that case, Ya Rasulullah, that place is better, and he gave the reason. So the Prophet ﷺ then took the whole camp, and he went to the other place. This clearly shows the Sahaba understood there's something from Allah and there's something from the human prophet in front of them, right? As well, this is illustrated in throughout the seerah. To be honest, there's more narrations even that can be said. So many narrations, the Sahaba understood that the Prophet ﷺ has been given the authority by Allah even to negotiate the Sharia. So for example, in the famous hadith after the conquest of Mecca, Bukhari and Muslim, our Prophet ﷺ forbade the plucking of the trees of Mecca. His uncle Abbas said, Ya Rasulullah, allow an exception for the tree of Idkhir, because Idkhir has benefits for us. Allow us to pluck Idkhir. Idkhir. The Prophet said, okay, you can pluck Idkhir. Now, what is important here? What am I trying to derive? Do you understand? Abbas radiallahu an, what is he doing? Negotiating with the Prophet ﷺ. He didn't say, oh, this is it, end of the story. He understood that there's a human element that he's allowed to deal with. Ya Rasulullah, make an exception for Idkhir. So an exception was made, and that exception is the Sharia to this day. The famous hadith also in Bukhari and Muslim, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to the Sahaba, I forbid you from gathering together in the pathways. Iyakum wa julus fi turuqat. Pause here, footnote. The Sahaba did not have a dining room, a formal living room, an informal living room, a family room, a salon, a drama room, this room. They didn't have that. They had one room, the house. So when they wanted to just chit-chat like all people want to do, where would they do it? In front of their house. And in front of their house is also what? The pathway. So the Prophet said, I forbid you from sitting in the pathway. The Sahaba began politely pushing back gently. Ya Rasulullah, we have to. Ya Rasulullah, where else are we going to meet? Ya Rasulullah, ma lana min mijalisina min bud. There have to be a place where we meet. What are they doing here? Negotiating. Going back and forth. So he said, if you must, then give the path its haqq. They said, what is its haqq? Lower the gaze, give salam to, and he gave the long list. Now what just happened here? Once again, back and forth. This clearly shows even the commandments of the Prophet ﷺ, the Sahaba understood that, look, if we can negotiate, we can negotiate. If not, سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. And that is why when Allah says, مَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ, this is totally valid. But that is when he has finalized. That is when the commandment has come. Then you have to hear and you have to obey. There are, as we said, some gray areas in the middle. Where does it apply to? And I'll give you some standard controversial examples that will, inshallah, then we don't have to go back to them later on, because I'm getting separate questions about that. So this is a question of methodology, and it deals with many subsidiary branches that we can go back to. Of the most obvious examples, of the most common examples, and I've gotten already a number of questions on this, is the dress code of the Muslim, especially amongst men. Is it sunnah to dress in the thawb? Or is it sunnah to wear a turban? Or is it sunnah to cover the hair? And this is an area where some of our scholars said category one, some of our scholars said category two. Because it's a middle, it's a bit of a both. Because some people said, okay, the Prophet ﷺ, especially when it comes to the hair covering, there are some traditions found in the tertiary books, al-Tabarani and the larger encyclopedias, not in the six books of hadith by and large. There are some ahadith that he commanded. The other group says all of these ahadith are weak, and they are weak. They are very weak, actually. They're not even weak, they're very weak. And the Prophet did not command us in any clothing item. And he wore a thawb because it was the garment of his people. And it is important to point out that Abu Jahl and Umayyah ibn Khalaf and Utbah ibn Rabi'a and all of the Quraysh wore the exact same garments as Abu Bakr and Umar. The turban, the thawb, it's exactly the same. If somehow we could be magically transported to the Battle of Badr and look at the two people on either side, we could not tell them apart from their dress. They're dressed the same. So the majority position, and this is the one that I strongly advocate, that the Prophet ﷺ did not come with a specific dress code for us. And therefore it is not sunnah per se. It is not legislative sunnah. Just like it is not sunnah to eat the cuisine of the Prophet ﷺ, to ride the beasts that the Prophet ﷺ rode, to live in the houses that the Prophet ﷺ lived in, so too, the same category, it is not sunnah to dress in the lifestyle of the Arabs of that time, or to have the head covering of the people of that time. And therefore, generally speaking, I don't have the topi, I have it because I'm ganja right now, because of the hajj I came back, so I'm, otherwise, generally speaking, I don't wear it at all. And Imam al-Shatibi, maybe 1,000 years ago, 800 years ago, Imam al-Shatibi was very explicit. He said, some of the scholars say one should cover the head covering as a part of Islam. But Imam al-Shatibi said, this is something that goes back to the culture of the people. In the cultural places where it is considered to be decent and dignified to cover the hair, so the Muslim should be decent and dignified. But Imam al-Shatibi, where was he from? He was from Andalus, from Shatiba, which is Yativa, which is a city in Andalus to this day. Yativa, X-A-T-I-V-A, Yativa, Shatiba. He was from Shatiba. And he said, the lands of the West, which is Andalus, in our culture, it is not considered a part of masculine dress to cover the hair. So he said, the Muslims of Andalus do not cover their hair. And the same applies in our times as well, that in my humble opinion, it is not legislative sunnah at all to dress in a thobe or to cover the hair, because this goes back to category three. Whoever wishes to make this argument, with my utmost respect, I say, will you resurrect the cuisine? Will you resurrect the architecture? Will you resurrect the other aspects of that culture? Number one. Number two, with my utmost respect, I'm not trying to be mocking at all, a'udhu billah. But even when you say you're going to dress like the Prophet ﷺ, and you dress in the finest, mashallah, Japanese cotton, and you have the air cufflinks and whatnot, and you have the Prophet ﷺ wore sheep, go and resurrect that style, and then see if you like that. It's not there. It's a very selective pick and choosing. Number one. Number two, Ibn al-Qayyim says, and Ibn al-Qayyim is well known. Ibn al-Qayyim is a traditionalist, alim, yani athari. Ibn al-Qayyim says, if you look at the sunnah when it comes to clothing, this is wallahi mind-boggling profound. Think about it. If you look at the sunnah when it comes to clothing, the sunnah is that the Muslim should try one's best to dress like his own people as much as the sharia allows. Because the Prophet ﷺ dressed like the Arabs of his time. So you don't look like a complete oddity, a complete stranger. Because if you are a total alien, a foreigner, then your theology will be made foreign. And your teachings will be foreign. And your morality is foreign. But when you speak the language of the people, and you look like the people, and you dress like the people, automatically an affinity is created. So Ibn al-Qayyim says, the real sunnah, sunnah al-haqiqiyyah, the real sunnah, is that you dress like your people as much as possible, so that there is an affinity that is created, and then that will then lead to a positive da'wah. So this is the first question that we have, and that is that there is no doubt rituals and theology and the halal and haram, sami'na wa ata'na. But that which the Prophet ﷺ did because he happened to live at a certain time, culture, place, that is not legislative upon us.
لا يزال الخير حيا لا يزال إن في الدنيا سلاما وظلال أخبر الأيام أنها في وصال قم بنا وانظر لآيات الجمال قم بنا وانظر لآيات الجمال